You're listening to the Beat Motel Zine podcast, and we need to warn you that we use words like shit, bollocks, scriptics, fuck, anarcho-syndicalist, and cunt, and we don't normally beep those words out, apart from the word cunt, because we're not total animals. Now, we know as well as you that your children can hear these words on any street in Britain, possibly any street anywhere in the world, but we also appreciate that you may not want to invite these words into your home if you have children or sensitive pets nearby whilst listening to this podcast. So listener discretion is advised. That being said, if your children aren't allergic to hearing words like fuck, shit, buttocks or hind penis, they might learn something from listening to this podcast, although probably not, because the quality of our educational content is quite poor. So there you go, fuckers, buckle in and let's get started.
I hate the idea that we're somehow going to offend an animal.
That's kind of more upsetting than the idea of offending a human, definitely. Although I've always lived with cats, and cats are offended by everything.
But they're also offensive about everything as well. So
that is true. Right, everyone watching YouTube can see I am now in terrifying HD. Although the focus does keep shifting. But look at that. That is really clear. I've managed to use my phone as the camera. What an age we live in.
The marvel of Apple.
Yeah.
And boom. As long as you keep within its sphere, it'll do everything for you. If you dare to try and watch Apple TV on a PC, you're fucked.
Does it not work?
It's a real pain in the ass because they only really trust their own devices.
See, the way it works on, because I'm Apple everything now, and the way it works is they say, do you want to watch this really cool thing on Apple TV? And you're like, fuck it, whatever. Because here you go, enjoy this. And then 9 months later, you find you've been paying like £15 a month for Apple TV and haven't watched any of it, which is what happened to me. I kept seeing things advertised and going, that looks good, like Foundation series by Asimov. Allegedly brilliant series of sci-fi books. I read the first one. It was like reading the notes from a council meeting. It was
it's like Star Wars number one, whatever, or Star Wars number four, depending on how you're counting.
See, Star Wars, A New Hope is Star Wars one, if your children ask. It's just good parenting. Yeah, the others do exist. Well, it's complicated now because some of the prequels they've got now are actually good. Anyway, this isn't a podcast about Star Wars, because Star Wars has got enough, just a bizarre amount of focus at the moment. I don't even know how many Star Wars things there are anymore.
I thought it was going through the same sort of thing of like Marvel, where they just burnt out on ideas and they weren't really producing anything worthwhile anymore. I quite like that standalone film where they did, what was it called? That was okay.
The one where everybody died.
Yeah. And for some reason, one of the Asian actresses got a lot of shit. Well, Asian actors, sorry for the genderizing of the term actor, got a lot of shit. For no reason, because she was actually pretty good at it. But, the media will make a thing about stupid white men being stupid white men.
God, how much longer? It's one of the things that annoys me most in life, is how stupid white people are. And I am othering there, because it's clearly not all white people, but when people with stupid opinions had their opinions confirmed by Brexit and then that fuck Muppet Boris Johnson getting in again, then things got slightly shitter. But this also, as much as this isn't a Star Wars podcast, it's also not a political podcast.
It's all clickbait, Andrew. It's all clickbait.
That's why we're doing
it. The whole logic of all media and everything you read in the press and all this crap. And what we're doing here is clickbait.
We are clickbait. I'm going to clip that and use it on one of these little. Do you actually follow Sam? Do you follow Beat Motel on Instagram?
I have given up Instagram because I want to protect my mental health a bit more than I have been doing.
Very wise. I'm only on it just to spam it with clips of us. So
I find myself sort of clicking on it too easily, and I just started to really hate my time on it.
I think any passive lack of choice in entertainment is not good. So I like Reddit, but I'm very cautious of it, and I don't use it every day. And I'll treat it a bit like the Sunday papers. Actually, I'll have a flick through Reddit, but anything that just pushes things at you, like we're on TikTok as well, and again we're just spamming it. I'm just spamming it with Beat Motel clips. But the thing I hate most about TikTok is that you open it and it just fires stuff at you. There's all this shit going around in my work world at the moment about, is TikTok a search engine? Of course it's fucking not. What a stupid thing to ask. But yeah, anything passive. Whereas people who choose to listen to the Beat Motel podcast are very wise. And that's
very
wise, a good choice.
Very wise and have too much time to kill.
I got shouted at on the walk to the studio today.
What was the shout?
Now I'm quite used to this, because if I drive an automobile, I just quite often get people shouting at me. I don't know why. I've never caused an accident or anything. I just seem to upset a lot of other road users. I thought
by
it was
obeying
in my head,
the law, like, Andrew, by obeying the law, by not being a bellend.
Probably is by, you know, I drive at 30 miles an hour through villages and stuff like that. I've been overtaken.
Even when they say 20 miles an hour.
Yeah, I've been overtaken in town, in Ipswich, in an urban centre, while I've been doing 30. I've been overtaken, God,
well,
four or five times in the last few months.
That happened to me at one point, yeah.
But then, so Izzy, my daughter, and my wife have both noticed as well, yeah, I do seem to upset other road users, and for reasons they can't figure out either. And, I mean, when you and I cycled a lot, we're used to upsetting road users as cyclists. You can go, okay, well, a lot of motorists seem to hate cyclists. But I walk everywhere now. I don't know how I'm upsetting motorists. This guy was on the other side of the road going the other way. And I'm literally just walking with my hood up, headphones in, listening to a podcast, completely in my own little world. Leaning right out of his window. I thought he was actually going to fall out. And really going for it. And I was like, what the fuck have I done? Have I upset? I kind of find that very strange. Maybe I've just got one of those faces that people want to yell.
I don't know. It was snowing here the other day, and I was walking back home. It was about a 40-minute walk I was taking, and I had my hood on as well, just to protect, you know, because it's fucking cold outside, and
it's insanely cold. You've got shouted at.
Yeah, but I think it was by bored teenagers in a car.
Because it's Helsinki, we're like, can't even fucking understand you. Say what you like.
Walking wanker.
You think that's what it's about? It's all just stemmed from In Between Us, right? Before we carry on, I'm going to fiddle around and move my camera, because I'm finding it really odd, sort of looking off to the side. So if I do it like that, I'm just doxing my own company name a bit there. It's wonky, but I don't care. Oh, shit. We are... Hey, I've got to move the Beat Motel sign as well. Ah, screw it.
Well,
across the room. There you go. It's gone. Right.
Well,
We are...
Andrew's gone.
We ought to talk about music at some point. Oh, someone's coming. Hello, Richard. Hello. I shouldn't... Oh, it's too late to hide my company name, isn't it? I mean, I'm already linked to the company through the podcast and all the other shit I do, so... Who cares? Anyway, we have been rambling for like nearly 10 minutes and we've not played any music. So should we do Riff of the Week?
Riff of the Week.
Yeah. Okay, let's start with your riff. I was just looking for a comma. Right there used to be a crack house. Now it's an organic garden. Tell me what they did when I'm black. Get slow when I'm money dead low. But the rent rise up. White folks coming at the blue. Then they tore that down. Then made that to a Whole Foods. Landlords looking for a payday. Numbers running scooters where we used to slang, yay. I love it when you recommend, well, you have hip hop in any of your suggestions.
Okay,
that
next,
bass is lovely at the start of that.
Next up is Limp Bizkit.
That
is Danny Brown with the song title Jenny's Terrific Vacation. And I always like a hip-hop song which I find the subject matter quite easy to discern, which is gentrification. And it is probably one of the highlights of Danny Brown's new album. And it's got a really, really interesting instrumental. And I always love it when, for me, the highlights of Danny Brown is when he's keeping pace over a consistently shifting background. And this track does that beautifully.
I've never heard of him. Who is he?
He's sort of quasi underground, quasi mainstream rapper, maybe not. But he's never had like a big pop song, but he's certainly well known. And he sort of he basically, a lot of his lyrics are very like everyday stuff. And he's one of those guys who takes a lot of drugs, but instead of making these songs that make you feel really good and want to take a lot of drugs, it sort of puts you off taking a lot of drugs.
Oh, I think you spoke to, not on the podcast, but I think you played me him before. When I came to see you, because you say you were seeing him one time, and at the end of the set, he's like, "You know, I've got to go to rehab now because this stuff isn't fun."
Oh no, that was a review I read of his. He did an album. He's done two albums. He's released two albums this year. One with a guy called JPEG Mafia, who produced all of it, and it's a really that's what I've played before, JPEG Mafia and Danny Brown, and this is his new. This is Danny Brown's new solo album, It's really, it's a really sort of, it's good piece of music. But also, he did this. My favorite album of his was called. Just get the name, because it is a reference you might get. It's called Atrocity Exhibition, which is a reference to Joy Division.
I thought it was going to be a reference to there's a book called Atrocity Archive by Charles Strauss, but I love that kind of hip hop. I absolutely love it. Any sort of hip hop that's, to quote a cliche, off kilter, you know, slightly odd. Speaking of odd hip hop, I'm quite foolishly trying to make my way through the Pitchfork Best 50 Albums of 2023. I don't know why. I never read Pitchfork. It just popped. Somebody put it on LinkedIn. I was like, yeah, I'll give that a go. So I'm reviewing them for Beat Motel, and they're on the same website as the Beat Motel podcast. And I listened to the Andre 3000 flute album. Have you heard it?
I've heard of it.
You've heard of it?
Yeah.
Well, the end of the review, I said, you know, something like the mark of whether I like an album or not is whether I will listen to it again. And I said, I will listen to this again, and I might even make it all the way through. I absolutely adore the fact that he's made a flute album. I mean, that's just for someone so high profile, and he really is. You know, they sold a lot of records.
If we didn't have to transition to, I mean, play your next track, that'd be a really nice transition to today's subject matter.
It would, which we will reveal in a minute, but. Yeah, I'd say listen to it, but it's directionless. I think it's interesting, but it's just directionless. It's got there's no sort of thread running through it, other than it's interesting, and it's not lol, I've got a flute. He takes it seriously. It's I love the fact it's happened. I think more than anything else, I love the fact it happened. That's my strongest feeling on it.
Yeah, it was sort of like. I mean, that's most of the, not most of the, but the media that I've read around it has basically been, well, this is a pretty left field thing for someone so high profile to do. And it's sort of, and the amount of good reviews it's got always highlights to me, and this is why I sort of semi hate this sort of stuff, highlights to me how willing people are to. Artists they like, rather than to go and look for the thing the artist themselves is being inspired by.
That's really interesting. I think there's a better chance of bands or people like this, like doing this kind of thing, opening doorways to other music. Yeah, I see what you mean. It's not looking at a genre, but it might help you explore a genre. I mean, it's weird. I mean, I think it's directionless. Cad, my bandmate, incidentally, I'm just going to say we packed out quite a large venue in Ipswich on Saturday, which was very nice. Cad, my bandmate, absolutely adores it. Thinks it's one of the best things she's ever heard. And I sort of demur to her on some things because her musical ability and skill is phenomenal. So it might be one of those things that if you're a really good musician, you might be able to hear loads of stuff in it that is really appealing. But if you're just a dumbass bassist like me, you might not spot it. So let's go on to my riff of the week. Oh, I went Suffolk then for a moment. Woo! That's Ghost of a Thousand. That's not new at all. That's I should have looked it up, but I think it might be like 2006, possibly. Brighton band, 2007, that album. And I looked it up because you played me... Oh, shit, I was going to say MIA. What are they called? You played me a band last week that were kind of hardcore.
Oh, Get some,
yeah. Listen to Get Some, and then just sort of got sort of reminded me so much of that kind of like mid 2000s hardcore. I just had to go listen to some, and I forgot how much I love that out. That Goes to a Thousand album. I love the vocals. How the hell do you sing like that? I mean, consistently and on tour.
We in my first band. At one point we were trialing singers, and we got a guy who was in like metalcore bands, and I'd never sort of hung out with these sort of growlers and grunters and all these sort of
growlers, shriekers, and grunters.
This is the title of my next book about extreme singers.
Growlers, sorry.
And
I always think there's a joke that whenever I hear growl, I'm always reminded of a joke I read. It might have been one of those Viz comic things. And it just, if Prince Charles was really born with a silver spoon in his mouth, did it scratch the Queen's growler on the way out? Oh, man.
No wonder he was sent away to receive no love. Basically this guy he hadn't trained his voice whatsoever, and so he was literally just being as brutal on his vocal cords, and he would cough up blood.
Oh no, there is a way to do it. I know. There is like technique. I've looked it up and tried to figure it out, because
there's,
the ship has sailed on me singing nicely in anything, but if I can at least be a growl.
You already are a bit of a growler, Andrew.
Oh dear, face like
this is
growler.
The acceptable version of the other word we're not allowed to say.
Yeah, don't say that other word. Although I was listening to this other podcast today.
How is it not more offensive?
I think growler is probably more offensive than that word, because
it's quite.
It's not exactly an overwhelmingly positive word, but I'm happy using it in the context of a dead monarch. yeah. So I was listening to a podcast called, I think it's called We Dig It. Again, I can check on the podcast app on my Mac. But it's a podcast by, We Dig Music is called. And it's a podcast by a couple of people travelled from Blackpool, to come see These Are End Times at the weekend. And they do a podcast. And I listened to it today. Each episode's like 2.5 hours long. It's wow. And it's quite fun. I'll put a link in the show notes. But they picked a year and picked a load of albums from that year. And they're discussing them and then sort of rating them. It's really cool. But they say that word that we don't say all the time. Mm. It's just so I was leaving it out because I thought for like banning, you know, getting in trouble with the puritanical Apple algorithm. But maybe we can say it, but let's not say it now because I haven't got time to edit this episode and take out those words. Right, so we need to move on. We are a third of the way through the episode and we haven't even talked about the topic yet.
It's so pretty standard.
As every week, do you want to tell me how you interpreted the topic and then I'll tell you how I fucked it up and got it wrong?
Well, I wanted to discuss sort of like people who had a creative peak and then they did something really different afterwards. And or they changed their sound substantially after that creative peak.
Oh, that's better than what I'd have got.
For better or worse, I have to say. It presented a bit of a challenge. Where did you go with it?
Well, I think I'll leave titling this episode up to you because the title I've got is really, really cranky. It's Difficult Albums After a Hit. So I was thinking, same thing, a band breakthrough album and very much doing that rather than being a difficult second album because that's just such a thing being discussed. Oh, yeah, we'll discuss cliches. I'll hug a cliche, definitely. But
I was looking for after like commercial peaks or mostly after commercial peaks, although it's not all after commercial peaks.
There's some really surprising examples. Let's play your first. And I think when you sent through the list of songs, when I saw this at the top, I thought, no, that can't be the band I think it is. There must be another band with the same name. And this is the most surprising thing you've ever sent me.
But I still have that painting we bought in Rome. The one I hated and you adored, now I own. There's no you. What's the point without you? There's no you. What's the point without
you? I was seeing if I could get the phone to shift focus.
So how do you feel about this band? This band is, of course, the Scouse band Space, and the song is There's No You.
How do I feel about the band? They were in a time of landfill indie bands. They were interesting. At the time, I was going through some sort of difficult music stage that I'm probably about a third of the way through now. So the strength of their songs, their singles were brutally strong. For me, they were like Supergrass, and I liked early Supergrass, but they were like Supergrass, but somehow sort of more intelligent, more sort of well thought out and a bit more rounded. But the singles, their hit singles off their first album were just stonkers. I think I bought the album. I can't really remember.
Spiders. I love their first album, Spiders. Absolutely. It came out in 96, something like that.
I'm so surprised. I am really so surprised.
And I was 12, 13 at the time and just sort of becoming, you know, sort of coming into my musical sort of world. And, the songs, I agree, the songs, they're incredible. The songs in the first album are incredibly strong. And then the second, and I was like, wow. And it obviously made a bit of a hit. And then their second album came out, Tin Angels. And I still have the tin version. I think, to my knowledge, that...
God, they must regret that. Sorry, they must regret putting the second album in a tin. They must have lost any money they were going to make by doing that.
Well, I can them and Pill, I think, are the only bands who have done it, really.
It's a bad idea.
And it's like... The first album is like, I can see like that sort of pop rock, but they also have a element of, he's a much more sort of, I don't know, he's got a very strong Scouse accent whilst at the same time having a great sense of like a, not at the same time, not to say that Scouse accent doesn't have a great sense of melody, but his sense of melody is something that is really pronounced and very, very in the front. the singer's sense of melody. And the second album, they sort of threw away the rock almost completely, and they sort of lent into this sort of quite loungy sort of. It's like they'd gone from early Elvis to late Elvis in the blink of an eye.
Wow, that's a good way of describing it. I think they're still going. They got back together.
This got me back into listening to them. I've listened to a few of their last albums, and they're just great songwriters. They're still going.
Still strong then.
Yeah, they're still going, and they explore quite a lot of musical varieties within their their songwriting, but they make it fit their own sound very well. Like, I think one of their last albums went a bit of 80s with the synths and stuff, whereas their early sort of stuff was all the synths was a bit retro-futuristic. Hence Tin Angels and sort of robots and stuff like this. And the lyrics are great. The lyrics are always really sort of fascinating, because it's like snapshots of sort of English suburban white life in the north, you know. So what your neighbour's doing, curtain twitches are a big part of, I think, the guy's sort of lyrical repertoire. And the second album, just sort of, they went from this rock band to this sort of loungy band, and it was like, what the fuck's going on? And it one of the things that annoys me the most about their set, I like their second album, but their first single is called Avenging Angels.
Yeah, and angels, kick-ass angels.
Yeah. The chorus comes in far too early. They should have done a double verse. the verse is too short. And it really annoys me.
You get that sort of thing on, I've always thought you get that sort of thing on bands' debut albums if they're on a fairly big label and it's just A&R pressure.
Well, what happened?
Get to the chorus.
What I understand, I did a bit of reading around, because I haven't looked them up.
You did research. You did research for the podcast, bloody hell.
A little bit. But apparently.
I just got an image of you sat on the crapper with your phone going, oh, we're recording in a bit. I probably ought to have a look.
Which hand did I wipe with?
I didn't wipe with your phone by accident.
probably wouldn't help the amount of bacteria on the screen. So apparently the opposite happened. So they had this first album that was a surprise how big they got on it, and then the A&R pressure to get bigger came down on them. And
really?
They buckled a little bit. Because they had that big single with Carey's Matthews about Tom Jones. And
oh,
then
And
then the singer was on Tom Jones's album as well.
That's a hell of a trajectory, isn't it?
Yeah. And then they recorded on around 2000, they recorded an album with Edwin Collins, which was shelved.
Oh, no. I was going to say that makes total sense. If you sort of think about the way they sound, it almost sounds like... Sometimes I like it when there's really bizarre rumours around a band when they start. Like there was a rumour that when the Killers started, there was a rumour that all their songs are written by, is it Don Henley from the Eagles?
Oh, right.
Because they just like, you know, think, oh, maybe he's too old, he's just put together a band, he's writing the songs in like early space. Edwin Collins is not a million miles away from the songwriting style and whatever. That makes total sense.
Yeah. And so after Angels, they sort of got dropped by that major label. And since they've sort of got back together, they've sort of gone much more back to that first album sound.
Takes the pressure off, doesn't it? Right, we're going to have to move on. I've got a meeting I can't avoid, and I'm going to just have to be unprofessional and check my calendar, because I'm pretty sure it's in half an hour. But yes, half an hour, that's fine. Right, so... as per usual, you've got a lovely, eloquent first suggestion that nicely summarizes a lot of things that about the theme of the show, and I've just done something complete opposite. Can you hear all this fucking banging around? It is insane. It's making the floor shake here. Anyway, so here's I wanted to go for an angle of, I was trying to think of bands that have tried to deliberately fuck up their career.
Good. I like that.
Yeah.
Power on!
Go on, Sam. Can you guess who that was?
Foo Fighters.
That's the Nirvanas.
The Nirvanas. Kurt Cobain and the Nirvanas.
I'm fascinated by In Utero, and I've never really figured it out, because at the time I can remember reading reviews, people saying that Kurt Cobain quite deliberately wanted to follow a similar trajectory to the Beastie Boys. And now, correct me if I'm wrong, I know shit all about the Beastie Boys and I need to look up more. No, because they had a surprise, like, massive hit. You know, Fight for Your Right to Party was astronomical, but then the album after was not just a rehash of that. It was actually, was it Paul's Boutique, the second album? So it was something that was just, whoa, and wasn't as well accepted by the public and was sort of seen. I often thought Nirvana were trying to do that, but then if you get Steve Albini in, you're not trying to make a shit album.
Well, the thing is that I personally never understood how people find In Utero so challenging, because maybe it's because how I came to those albums. So I was probably, in a way, I was aware of probably In Utero before I was Nevermind, because of my age and of the fickleness of MTV playlists in the day. And I can see it's a harsher album, but I can certainly hear the same band. Whereas if you compare I understand that it was like a reaction to the immense, partly a reaction to the immense popularity of Nevermind, which is probably very overwhelming, particularly for the, people at the center of it. But at the other side of the aspect, there is definitely a continuation. And you can sort of say, I understood that Nevermind was them going, okay, well, if we're going to have this money, we might as well sort of make as much of a pop record as we can make a pop record. And then going, well, fuck it, we've done that, so let's just do what we actually do. Because, you can certainly, the sonics, the production is very different, but it's not challenging in the way that if they had done like a followed up Nevermind with an analog version of Metal Machine, Lou Reed album. It's not that, is it?
I nearly chose Metal Machine, but I don't think you can really say that Lou Reed had a hit before it, particularly. So, when I first met my wife, we lived, she lived in some nurse's flats. I just went there and stopped going home. She flushed my copy of In Utero down the toilet.
Why?
Because everyone else in the flat hated it so much. They found it completely unlistenable, which is so weird to think back. I liked it. I mean, Nevermind was such a kind of, whoa, everybody was really blindsided when that came along. Regardless of what genre of music you're into, I'm not going to start going on about how great Nevermind was, but In Utero, I found much, much more exciting. It opened my mind to a lot of far noisier music. I mean, listening back now, it's hardly challenging music, really. It's not, but yeah, it got flushed.
But it's basically the same band, except on Nevermind, everything's really well sort of engineered and it's a very precise album. And in Utero, everything's just peaking and it sounds like everything's peaking. And it sounds, I love that album. I just don't get why some people say it's so challenging and so different, because at the heart of it, there are still a handful of amazing pop songs.
Oh God, so some of the songs, I'm not saying, I like it, I really like it, but some of it is so strong and there's so much some banging around here. It sounds like there's flooring, they're laying flooring out there. It sounds like there's about 10 apes doing it. I can remember looking through the tape, the tape artwork, and reading the lyrics and going, fuck, this guy is really unhappy. It was so soul-bearing at the time, but we need to move on, and we're going to play your next song, which I'm going to say is another real surprise.
Well,
you had prepared the clips for this episode, I would not be able to guess who that was.
Who was that?
No chance. That was the Smashing Pumpkins. Oh, they actually are called the Smashing Pumpkins. Are they the Smashing Pumpkins?
I think it changes.
Smashing Pumpkins, and the song is called Pug. Which album's that off?
That's from, was the album called A Door? I think it's the album called, it's called A Door.
Is that the one after Gear?
Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness.
Ah, that's it, yeah. That the rise of that album really surprised me at the time. Because I'd heard a couple of songs off Gish, like Siva, and kind of went, at the time I wasn't really into metal as I saw them at the time. But then that Melancholy album was just everywhere, Saturation.
Yeah, I mean, and then they lost. They basically lost their drummer, who's a sort of amazing musician. If we ever get to the point where we talk about our favorite drum fills, he'll probably fill every single one of my choices. And we might do that, might we?
It's a good idea. I'm going to make a note of that because I like that as an idea.
But Jimmy Chamberlain, they sort of lost him to, I think, heroin for a bit.
He was.
And they sort of Billy Corgan created an album that was really like low key, like there's no big explosions, and it was a really interesting sonic project, and it was a really interesting way to follow up. Okay, you've made this double album, and it's one of the biggest albums of the decade. And so you're going to follow up this double rock album, opus thing, and you're going to do exactly what we're talking about. You're going to go in a completely different direction, almost.
I'd love to hear the discussions that happen with that with A&R when bands do things like this. Because
he could probably do what he wanted by that point.
Yeah, there must come a point where you've made so much money. Especially if it's around re-signing or whatever. So if you signed a 2 or 3 album deal and you're due to make another album, you probably have got quite a bit of freedom, haven't you? You just go somewhere else.
It's like remortgaging when you've got a bit more money in the bank. I never got into Gish so much, but I really love Siamese Dreams and Melancholy and Infinite Sadness. They're two of my favorite albums of the 90s. And then Avarador came along, and I like it as an album. I think it's not it's underrated, but it's such a weird thing to do immediately after such commercial success.
I think I'm going to have to revisit them. There's something that put me off Billy Corgan, and I can't remember what it is.
He's a bit of a tit.
Oh, all right with people being a bit of a tit. If they're unpleasant with him. Like knowingly being buzzed. Oh, I meant to tell you, this is more, I'm going to mention it on the podcast, but there's a really good documentary about Hypnosis, the people who did the people who did all the album covers in the 60s, late 60s, early 70s.
Oh, nice.
There's a documentary on them called Squaring the Circle. It's on Netflix at the moment that is just, Emma and I watched it last night, and it's brilliant. Really good. I was really surprised how good it was. But one of the two guys from Hypnosis was legendarily an asshole. Like, very, very difficult to work with. But you've got all these people like Dave Gilmour saying how much he loved him. So, you know, maybe, I don't know, I'm not going to start going on about Billy Corgan. Let's have another song, sir. We don't have to listen to these people banging the fucking floor out there. Want to guess? No, Stone Roses. I really thought long and hard about whether to include this band because the first album wasn't a hit. I mean, it grew and gained an unbelievable amount of momentum, but still very underground. Then they signed to Geffen for like 52 million after a 5.5-year long legal battle with their previous label. and released an album, which I've said many times on this podcast, it's awful. But I tried to choose the most awful point and I just couldn't bring myself to do it. So I chose something that I think is actually good. They like a dance music track with live instruments that I think is pretty decent. But I remembered while I was making the clips that I really like Blue Tones, band Blue Tones, like Space. I think they've stayed interesting. They've not had like tons of commercial success, but all the albums are really, really good. And back when this album came out, Blue Tones used to do a fanzine. Because a lot of bands did back in the 90s, you would still go to a gig and on the merch table there'd be a fanzine that they'd made. And I can remember reading the fanzine and the singer, Mark Morris of the Blue Tones, basically saying, just talking about how terrible the album was and really going into depth. And about 3 years ago, Mark Morris was playing at Ipswich Beer Festival. And we had loads of people, you know, drinking beer and whatever. And he was up there with an acoustic guitar, you know, doing songs, which I think must be a tough crowd. So I spoke to him afterwards and I said, oh yeah, thanks for ruining the second Stone Roses album for me. And he just looked at me and I thought, shit, I've given him no context for that at all. Absolutely not. He was an absolute gent about it. I then sort of said, no, you did a fanzine. And he was like smiling and nodding politely. And I think probably thinking, I hope this drunk person wanders off soon.
That's why it's a tough crowd.
Yeah, but the second Stone Roses album, I've talked about it enough before, but I decided I had to put it in the list because it's a band that was completely overwhelmed by the weight of expectation and I think lacked a real direction to back it up. So let's not talk about Stone Roses anymore. Do you know, I was surprised by this suggestion by you as well. And then I was surprised that I actually kind of liked it. That's how it is. It's like trombone.
Well, they have so many people, they have to give them like all different sections. It's the Slipknots.
The Slipknots, yes.
The Slipknots with People Equal Shit. This is a weird selection for me, but I realised something that I remember when Slipknot first came out, I bought the album. I was like a teenage metalhead, like all teenage metalheads. Or a lot of us in the late 90s. I didn't really know there was an underground, so Slipknot introduced me to a lot of the more extreme stuff going. They were heavier than your average nu metal band, let's say.
I've always been amazed how massive they are for how extreme they are.
Well, the thing is that the first album is very much within like the heavier end of nu metal slash sort of towards sort of groove metal, the stuff that, you know, sort of the genre very much associated with Pantera, sort of mid-paced, you know, groovy riffs. But, you know, within that sort of world. And they had this massive, massive, I don't know how big that first album was, but this massive album, they decided to double down on their success by going more extreme. And since then, they've introduced more things like, you know, there's as far as I could figure out, there's more singing on their first album than their second album, which is the opposite trajectory of almost every other band who sort of goes, we're going to tone down the screaming and go more melodic. They sort of went, no, we're going to up the ante on everything, apart from the melody bit. We're going to go more and more. And I, by that point, I had sort of dismissed them as a gimmick. There's a certain gimmick to them which I find very grating, this whole mask thing, and the whole nine members thing.
I've done both of those things in bands, I just realised.
I don't mind them when they're done with the evidence. I mean, maybe you haven't done the members thing, you know, when you're in a ska band.
No, End Times had nine members at one point.
But, you know, I don't mind the big numbers thing, but there was a point they made about the big numbers thing. And everybody sort of, you know, you have three percussionists one of them was on a dustbin.
The big band thing just reminded me that Mark Radcliffe, who anyone not in the UK, he's always a long running DJ who's always been kind of on the alternative side of things. In his autobiography, he wrote about, he said in the early 80s with ska bands, he's Noddy Holder's drummer now, anyway. He said, ska bands, he said he was in a ska band that got so big that they started off doing like substitutions, like a football team was. Then his ska band got even bigger to the point they could play in two different towns on the same night at the same time.
I imagine trying to, you know, book rehearsals for a ska band would be a fucking nightmare. But you know, like, hats off to Slipknot, even though I've dismissed them and I haven't really listened to that album, you know, since it first came out. They went the opposite direction, and since then they've had like moments of melody, but instead of sort of going melodic, they introduced like chromatic death metal riffs, and it's like and they went bigger, you know. It's like, it is again, it's that sort of thing that Nirvana did of like, and or it's that thing that what's he called from Outkast has recently done, Andre 3000. It's sort of that thing of like, you have a platform and you introduce an extreme version, extreme thing to that platform, and people, and all of a sudden the people have bought into your brand or your sort of your thing find a way of accepting it rather than going, oh no, they've gone a bit far.
I will still struggle to go back and reassess Slipknot in an objective way. When I had my record shop, the only kids that ever gave us any shit were kids wearing Slipknot t-shirts. And in Ipswich, at least, seeing someone in a Slipknot t-shirt was almost a... you could almost tell what they'd be like and what their attitudes was. It was at a time in my life where I was very much into the anarcho-punk side of things, which everything is so much about being a good human being that I could not listen to music that was so overtly negative. And I can remember Corey Taylor?
Yeah,
him saying the only reason he started the band is to make the rest of the world as hateful as he is. And I was just like, I just want no part of that whatsoever. Now I understand metal better, and I'm kind of like, well, it's all part of the pantomime. Listen, yeah, might mean it.
But I mean, I think that's also the thing that irks me about it, is that, and this is the thing that pisses me off continuously about sort of a lot of metal, is that it's just like, maybe this is my insecurity, but I sometimes need a knowing wink.
Yeah, God, yeah. Oh my, that you have just summarized pretty much everything about metal. That's amazing.
You know, it's like, you guys know, I mean, it really is this thing of, I trust punks to know that they're being ridiculous. I don't trust metalheads to know that they're being ridiculous.
No, it troubles me. I'm really sorry, Sam, but we have got a hammer on. No, so
go.
Do you want to have a guess who that was?
Sounded very Pink Floyd-y.
It did, actually. Funny you say it's not Pink Floyd. It's Suede.
Oh.
It's one of my favourite bits from their second album, Dogman Star. And that lift, I want to play that lift up, because it comes after quite a pronounced, long, noodly bit. But that from the second Suede album, it kind of did do well. I mean, Suede have never had an album that hasn't done well. But the first album was so, had this real aggressiveness to it, which I really like, real sort of like angry David Bowie aggressiveness. But the second album, the band was imploding. Having read Brett Anderson, the singer's book, it's amazing they ever released the second album, ever got through the recording process, because they were a band who were actively hating each other by then, and had weirdly fallen out with Ed Buller, the producer. And yet he was still insisting on sticking around. So I put that in as a choice just because that album, which the band themselves don't like, has some great moments in spite of that. It's a real victory through adversity kind of thing from a creative side.
But, you know, sometimes those albums where you feel like the musicians are going in their own different directions can be the best because, you know, there's a tension in the recording of it.
You know, the last Spaceman 3 album. Have you heard of Spaceman 3?
You've mentioned them a few times.
Yeah, the last Spaceman 3 album, basically one writer got one half of the record and the other writer got the other half of the record. So it is two different records. It's literally two different records with different band members and everything. And then one of them became spiritualized. Right. I'm really intrigued by this next one, so I'm going to play it.
Hey, now I'm in love. Oh, where is that famous, majestic feeling? Now that I'm in love, why am I crying almost all the time? Stories I heard about love, oh, how they praised it up to the ceiling. Now that I'm in love, why am I not?
Gone. Who's that? Tell us who it is.
That's Vic Goddard and the Subway Sect. That is the song, Hey Now, I'm In Love.
Brilliant timing for you choosing this. There's a podcast I like called Just Three Lads, which surprisingly is American with a title like that. And I'm halfway through an episode they've done called Life After Punk. So they've done a theme where it's who completely changed or had a radical shift who started in punk. So there's the obvious ones like I'm not going to even bother. But they talk at length about Vic Goddard. And I didn't, you've talked about it before, but I didn't really understand his trajectory. That I knew he'd done swing, but I didn't realize how sort of soon after his other stuff it was. And it's the same band, and it's all written by him.
Yeah, and the next album's even weirder because he got like a... And this is all. This was on the previous singles they'd released was on Rough Trade Records, which isn't massive, but it's big. It's particularly in the day. And then they signed with MCA Records.
MCA, really?
Yeah. And then after this album, they released. He recorded an album called Trouble. With a group of London jazz musicians.
But I love the fact they're all called Subway Sect.
Yeah. I think their last one was maybe Vic Goddard. He was one of Randy Rhoads. Bernie Rhoads.
I could say Randy Rhoads. from?
Oh, that was the other one. Bernie Rhoads, who was the Clash manager, signed up to push Vic Goddard, and so they went from they went incredibly quickly from like teenage punk rock, early punk rock stuff to swing, and a bit flat, I'd say, not the most like rounded sort of jazz music ever, but. What the fuck?
Well, at least it existed. Right. The next song, I'm going to announce it and then we'll play out to this. I don't think it needs any explanation at all. This is Who Killed Bambi from the great rock and roll swindle by the Sex Pistols. Sam, thank you very much. Listeners, thank you very much. Love you dearly. Bye. We can't just stop on that, can we? Just give me your thoughts on that.
Well, I mean, I take offence that must be considered a forbidden music in your house.
It's forbidden music for me.
Yeah, it's fucking awful.
Ed Tudor Pole, isn't it? From Swords of a Thousand Men. Bloke. I've got to go. Love you, Sam. Bye.
Have a good meeting.